Hi, I'm Denise Keenan. I am a registered occupational therapist and a certified hand therapist. I practice in the area of upper limb rehabilitation, and I have seen many individuals who have suffered arm amputations. I was asked to assist with the preparation of this tape, and the tape's main purpose is to act as a guide for you who are just beginning work with upper limb amputees, and more specifically those who have chosen to use electric prostheses. The tape may also be beneficial to prosthetists or patients for viewing, but please remember that it should not be considered a replacement, if you will, for the qualified physical or occupational therapist working with you. The table of contents will show you that the tape is divided into sections, and there is a time allotment for each section. This will be helpful for your review after you view the entire tape. Regarding the choice of prostheses, there are many, and there are many choices available for every level of amputation. These choices range from the cosmetic and passive hand or arm prosthesis to the more conventional and utilitarian hook prosthesis. This tape specifically will address those who have chosen to use an electric prosthesis. The advantages of the electric prosthesis are that there's a more natural appearance to the hand, and it also allows for a very high pinch force, which requires less effort from the user. Also, the electric prosthesis is more comfortable to wear, and the harnessing can therefore be reduced, which makes it beneficial to the wearer for a longer period of time. It is important to note, though, that with the electric hand, it is often heavier than the more traditional hook, and because of this, the patient's ability to tolerate that weight must be considered. In training, consider the patient's work, home, and recreational activities. Their needs and goals are most important, though, and it's also important to recognize that they may have previous experience with other prostheses. Many amputees engage in a variety of activities, and they need several types of prostheses to perform these. For example, someone may use an electric prosthesis during most of their work activities, although choose to wear a body-powered prosthesis, which is more water-tolerant, when they go fishing. And some people use their prosthesis for a few key activities at work or home, and otherwise they use no prosthesis at all. Whatever their choice is, the purpose of therapy is to maximize their potential to use the prosthesis in their daily life. To summarize, the advantages of the electric prosthesis is the more natural appearance of the electric hand over a hook, combined with a higher pinch force, and less discomfort from control cables, a greater work envelope, and less effort to operate. The disadvantages with the current electric prostheses are a higher cost and greater complexity, so it may require more careful use, such as avoiding water or dirt inside the mechanism or the electronics. The patient must also be consistent about changing their batteries, replacing the battery when it runs down, and charging the battery. Another disadvantage is the higher weight, which is usually associated with the electric hand as compared with the hook-type prosthesis. And the intimate fit required for myoelectric arms can mean a longer fitting time, and close follow-up by the prosthetist will be required to maintain this proper fit. The individuals who are helping us with this tape are all wearers of electric prostheses, although some trade off with their body-powered prostheses for different activities. Red is a student in California. He lost his arm below the elbow 7 years ago in a car versus pedestrian accident. Rick lost his hand 25 years ago in a motor vehicle accident. He is a wrist disarticulation amputee wearing a myoelectric hand with a digital controller. He resides in Minneapolis, Minnesota, and he is an external power specialist doing technical training for Ottobock Orthopedics. Bob suffered a transhumeral amputation 6 years ago in an electrical accident. He is a carpenter in Oregon. Esther also lives in Oregon. She underwent a four-quarter amputation 2 years ago to remove a cancerous tumor. Kathy works in a clothing store in Indiana. She became a short transhumeral amputee 2 years ago after a car accident. Eric is a printer in New Hampshire. He lost his arm above the elbow in a work-related accident 2 years ago. When you first received the referral to work with a client who suffered an upper limb amputation, it's important for you to recognize that there are some basic intervention strategies that need to be initiated. Whether or not the person has already been fit with a temporary prosthesis, or perhaps even their definitive prosthesis, or whether they have just recently suffered their amputation, you still need to address the issues of wrapping of the residual limb for shrinkage, desensitization, and range of motion. Red has joined us, and he's willing to share some strategies with you and also to be active in demonstrating some of these techniques. In terms of the issue of wrapping the residual limb, for the primary purpose of stump shrinking, the main reason that we do this is to get the limb to shrink to its smallest size and to minimize the effects of recurrent swelling. And so the client is instructed to wrap the limb or to use some sort of a shrinking technique pretty much 24 hours a day until the arm's dimension and size has stabilized. The wrapping can be accomplished with a simple ACE wrap. It's important to always start at the distal end of the residual limb and work proximally. You and I will find it very easy to use a figure eight technique to wrap the residual limb. The challenge to us is to help a client understand and learn a strategy for doing that themselves. And that's possible. Typically, I'd ask the individual to hold the end of the ACE wrap by their side with their stump so that their free hand, in this case, Red, your left hand, once you're stabilizing that end of the wrap, you could do the wrapping then by mostly working with your left hand. Mm-hmm. So it is important that the client understand the necessity for wrapping, the purpose of it, as well as learning some strategies to do it on their own. If you didn't have an ACE wrap available, there's also many brands of elasticized tape on the market that can be used. This is not adhesive tape, but it is a self-adherent tape that's part cloth, which is comfortable. And perhaps the easiest way is to use some sort of a stump shrinking sock. This is simply cut from a roll of compression sock. Two techniques. I could either have Red pull this on all the way up to the end where the rubber band is, which provides some conformity to the distal end of the stump. Another technique is, without using a rubber band, to don the sock and simply twist the bottom portion and then take the remaining sock and pull it back over the limb. That would only be used if you had a person who could tolerate the double thickness of compression. So you may need to start with this technique initially. It's important to address the area of desensitization. Many of your clients will have residual superficial pain or hypersensitive areas. Many will also experience deeper pain sensations. We need to address that in a therapeutic setting. And the main thing that we will instruct folks in, if it's superficial pain, is the concept of overstimulating non-pain receptors. You're overstimulating all of the sensory endings that will pick up light touch. You basically progress from soft objects or even fabrics if you are instructing a client in rubbing their residual limb on a pair of pants or a towel or a shirt. You'll progress from soft into rougher textures, perhaps a terry cloth towel, moving into a sponge. And the idea is to work along the incisional area if that's the site of greatest discomfort. Some people actually have discomfort sort of generally and diffuse throughout the extremity. You would use the same technique and just work in a greater surface area. Did you experience any of this hypersensitivity or pain in your limb after your amputation?
No, just the phantom pain.
Okay. And did you develop any neuromas?
Yes. About 6 months afterwards, they did another operation and did some reconstructive surgery and took a neuroma out.
Okay. It's important to note that sometimes as you're working with this and you get a patient through the area of tolerable resistance, that they still may down the road develop some of those other tender areas. Light textures into pressure and eventually into tapping, which requires a different sensory feedback system. And this can be the most uncomfortable for a person who's got some hypersensitivity. In the area of pain control, you may find that TENS units are helpful to individuals in terms of trying to desensitize that deeper level of pain. Weight bearing is also an effective technique to use to help a person increase some proprioceptive feedback in the arm and decrease some of the pain. Another technique would be massage. Deep friction massage can help to decrease painful areas. And surprisingly, going through what would be considered normal and natural motion. If a person feels cramping in the hand that is constant, you work with them on exercising to release that tension. Regardless of the level of amputation, it's important to maximize range of motion in all the residual joints. In your situation, Red, you have, as far as I understand, normal function of the shoulder and elbow. Did you suffer any injuries to those joints?
No.
Okay. It would be important for Red to maintain full elbow range of motion. Your elbow essentially bends and extends.
Yes.
So do you have full range as far as you can perceive compared with your left?
Yes, okay. Full range.
The other thing that's important in the below elbow amputee is to maintain full supination and pronation. Have you ever worked on rotation of your forearm?
You mean as if my hand was still there?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And it
in other
really
words, resting here, you actually can rest by your side. Let's say you try to rotate your forearm as if you were turning palm up.
Right.
Okay.
That's up.
And as if you were turning palm down. Even though you don't have that lever arm there, there's still quite a bit of activity, especially at the proximal end of the forearm, which is really where your supinator and pronator muscles are housed. You probably have some residual muscle fiber there. Because once you put on that prosthesis, it may be also a helpful site to be used for site probing. So it's worth maintaining that rotation of the shoulder, of the elbow. It's important to take a person through full range of motion of the shoulder and also working into the neck. For people with above elbow amputations or higher level of amputations, similar to Bob's situation, we're going to work on range of motion. It's essential that you maintain as much range of motion as possible in the affected extremity. You will use as a therapist any conservative means you have to try to increase range of motion. This would occur prior to fitting with the prosthetic arm, but it's also an ongoing portion of your therapy once a person is fit with an arm if you're still dealing with limited range of motion. So with the above elbow amputee, it's important that you separate glenohumeral joint motion from scapulothoracic joint motion so that you break down each range of motion that you're looking at in assessment and then in educating your client in terms of exercises to perform. With glenohumeral motion, as you know, we're going to look at shoulder flexion, extension, abduction, adduction, and rotation. Bob, what I want you to do is demonstrate for us the amount of shoulder flexion you have. So you're going to raise your arm in front of you and as high as you can go. So you have excellent range of motion in that direction. If you were to work on shoulder extension, you'd be pushing your arm behind you, directly behind you, in as great a range as you have. Very nice. Do you have pain with either of those motions?
A little back here, I do.
Okay.
Yeah.
Then another motion that's important for you to maintain if you were working on an exercise every day would be abduction, bringing your arm out to the side of your body and up as high as you can reach. Nice. And then you're going to bring that arm down, bringing it all the way into your chest wall and actually squeezing a bit would be full adduction or adduction. Very nice. What I want you to think about doing is with your elbow by your side, I want you to rotate your hand out to the side of your body. Okay, and you can watch and you can feel that muscle activating. Mm-hmm. I also want you to rotate your arm across the front of your body. Okay? Do you get a sense of some movement in the shoulder joint?
Yeah.
The other way to work on rotation, and if a person has good abduction of the arm, you also want to work on that rotation with your arm elevated. You can bring your arm out to the side. Mm-hmm. Holding it in that position now, I want you to practice rotating up with the hand or the arm. I also want you to practice rotating fully forward. And you can see the amount of motion occurring in this joint. Okay, relax. Those are the essential motions that you need to maintain in this joint to keep it functioning at its optimal level. You may not always work with those motions with your prosthesis on, mm-hmm. so it is important that you maintain those. Okay, if you can turn around for me, we're also going to look at the scapulothoracic joint and the motion of the shoulder blade. The key motions here to look at are protraction of the shoulder blades, which is the action of spreading those shoulder blades apart. Mm-hmm. So if you will, I want you to kind of expand the back, and you can very clearly see and watch, and you can probably feel, Bob, that shoulder blade moving away from your spine, and then relax. Don't actually flex forward as much with your waist. I just want to see if you can feel the spread across your back. Yes, and then relax. Shoulder, scapular, if you will, protraction. To work on scapular retraction, which is also very important, he's going to work with the muscles alongside the spine as well as those below and on the medial aspect of his shoulder blade. I want you to practice squeezing your shoulder blades together. The common pattern you'll see people engage in is a lot of arm motion, and they tend to get all of their retraction up high. It's very important to keep strength in the latissimus muscles and also to move the entire scapula, that you also practice working from down low. Mm. So as you squeeze your shoulder blades together, think about there being a little walnut right here you're trying to squeeze. Mm. Your arm actually is going to follow. All the motion comes from these muscles. So squeeze and relax. Very good. Scapular retraction. Scapular elevation, I want you to shrug your shoulders. Nice. Okay, you don't need to roll forward. You're just actually going to shrug as if you were saying, I don't know, and relax. Now do this just on the right side. And relax. And he's elevating his scapula. Do that again. And relax. Scapular depression is also important, and it kicks in the muscles below the shoulder blades. I want you to practice taking both shoulder blades and pushing down either to your waist or to the floor. Okay, it's a pretty subtle motion, and relax. Push down and relax. Think this time, Bob, about pushing down in back. Don't roll forward. Use your back muscles to pull your shoulder blades down. Okay, very good. And relax. The shoulder blade naturally has a rotation component. When the arm is moved with your left arm, just practice reaching out in front of you, reaching overhead. You will see a rotation here, and then bring your arm back to your side. Okay? There's quite a play in that shoulder blade. You don't want to let that freeze up. You will either eventually develop some muscle imbalances that can cause pain syndromes to occur. You will also potentially limit range of motion if you allow muscles to tighten up. So on the right side, practice the similar motion that you just did, reaching your arm forward in front of you out at an angle, and you can watch the nice rotation of the shoulder blade out to the side, and then as it rolls back in. Okay, very nice. You turn around and face us all again. So again, separating glenohumeral from scapulothoracic motion, maintaining as much range of motion as is possible. What I would recommend to you is at least once a day, you go through full range of motion of your shoulder, not to forget also the head and neck motions, mm-hmm. to keep all of this stretched out and to avoid any tightening of muscles above that shoulder. Esther here is an example of a person who has undergone a four-quarter amputation. When we talk about range of motion in her situation, in preparation for the prosthesis wearing and fitting, there isn't a whole lot of motion that will have a direct relationship to that. But I think it's important to address the fact that any joints that are mobile should stay as mobile and as supple in terms of muscle connection as possible. What I would ask you to address with your clients would be making sure that you maintain full neck range of motion. I would ask you, Esther, to tip your left ear down to your left shoulder to provide a nice stretch through here and to keep good range on this side of the neck. And if you can drop your right ear down to where your right shoulder would be. Okay. Also, your neck, Esther, would flex forward. Mm-hmm. And you would also be able to look up at the ceiling. Mm-hmm. Okay, so you're going to go through full neck range of motion. There's also some neck rotation. If you were to turn and look towards me, you can feel a little bit of a pull on these muscles and a stretch over here, and to also turn your head in the other direction. So you're going to go through full neck range of motion, which is important. Let me have you turn in your chair so that your back is facing the camera. In terms of some range of motion posteriorly, Esther does have her left scapula intact, but the right scapula has been removed. Can I see you do some shoulder circles with your left shoulder? You're going to maintain as much range of motion in your residual scapular thoracic joint as possible. And Esther, I'm going to ask you to rotate the right shoulder as it would normally rotate. What you're seeing here is that there is some mobility of this entire side of the quadrant, and it's important to maintain that mobility. What you want to eliminate is any frozen position of any mobility that an individual has. Okay, and relax there. Don't also forget about latissimus muscles and also trunk range of motion. I would ask you to rotate at your waist. So you're turning towards me. Mm-hmm. You could do this in sitting or in standing. And then you could turn the other way, rotating your waist the other way to keep a nice rotation here. Esther, one other thing. Can I ask you to imagine yourself raising, and actually you could do this with your left arm as well. Raise both arms up as high as you can in the air. We're straight out in front of you. You're going to get a little bit of rotation of the shoulder blades and a little bit of neck range and thoracic range. If you take them through general range of motion of the glenohumeral joint and the scapulothoracic joint. Okay, thanks. If you want to turn around, I think it's also worthy to address your sternoclavicular joint. Now, there is no clavicle on the right side, but it's important to work with an individual on chest expansion, trying to really spread your ribs out in front and pull your shoulders back. Mm-hmm. And then to relax forward. Okay, very nice. You may be involved in muscle site probing and testing for the client who will be fit with an electric prosthesis. There are a variety of EMG equipment monitors on the market. The one we're going to show you here is Motion Control's MyoLab 2. This is a two-channel EMG tester. It is essentially going to give us information about what the EMG measurement of a muscle is in microvolts. The typical setup is to turn the power on to leave your gain at times 1 and your gain channels down here at 10. With the setup this way on this particular unit, you will be getting a readout of microvolts in the 0 to 100 on a full scale. This unit is also equipped with sound dials, which we will turn on briefly. You may choose to use the sound dial for auditory biofeedback, or you may choose to just work with the visual feedback of the needle. Now, initially, when you're probing for muscle sites, what you're going to instruct the client to do is to activate the sound arm initially to identify the potential muscle, then to work with both arms together, and then to work with the affected limb in isolation. And if you work in that sequence of control, you will most likely be able to help them get some feedback from the appropriate muscle. So we're going to go ahead and turn the MyoLab on, and I'm going to ask you, Red, on your left arm to practice either bringing your wrist back or opening your fingers and see if you can activate a muscle up here in your forearm. Push against my hand. And do you feel a muscle working in the forearm? Okay. I want you to do the same motion now on both arms together. See if you can activate that muscle on the right side. And we will watch the MyoLab to see if we can see the needle move. So we're looking at the needle on channel B. You're trying to elevate it. Very good. That's working both sides together. We're getting a nice microvolt readout. The sound that accompanies that. Okay. Now relax completely. Try the same function on just the right arm by itself. Again, we're looking at channel B. Very nice. He's reading a full-scale microvolt with channel B. Okay, relax for a moment. We're going to do the same thing now for another muscle site. I'm going to ask you with your left arm to practice either bending your wrist or making a fist against my resistance. Okay, so you work on a fist and relax. And do you feel muscle contraction on the inside of your elbow?
Yes.
Okay. Let's try the same thing with both arms working together. And we're going to look at channel A on the MyoLab. So you're going to squeeze both hands and relax. And again. Does that take a little more or less work than the other muscle? Okay.
It's kind of hard to just control the A side without moving the B.
Okay. As you're doing this, you're going to map the placement of your electrode, then you may move that electrode in very small increments so that you can find an optimal site. Try to do the same thing again with both arms, making a fist and watching channel B, and relax. Relax completely. One more time with both arms together. We're going to try to watch the needle on B move up the scale.
You want
and
B?
Relax. B, yes.
Then it'd be opening.
Okay, and then relax like that, that one. Okay, and let's try channel A. That's up the closing. Scale. There you go. Nice. Okay. The last phase of muscle probing would be to relax this extremity. You're going to work just with the affected limb. So I'm going to ask you once again to try to find the muscles on the outside of your arm and to watch the microvolt readout on the dial. Just using your right arm. You're going to open your fingers and relax. Nice job. Try the same thing on channel A. You're going to close those fingers and relax. Very nice. So this was an example of one particular EMG tester. And again, there may be other testers that you will use in your clinic setting that will help you to identify optimum muscle sites for electric control. There are guidelines for selecting myoelectric control sites. A minimal signal of 5 microvolts will operate the most sensitive system. However, patients with only minimum signals should be capable of developing stronger signals for longer-term prosthetic use. Independent contraction of each muscle, so the prosthetic function is smooth and controllable. As a general guideline, you can start prosthetic use with a 10 microvolt difference. But the patient will use the prosthesis easier if 20 to 30 microvolts difference can be controlled. Look for the strongest difference between the two sites, not necessarily the strongest signal on each. Look for the natural agonist-antagonist pairs, for example, the biceps-triceps, wrist flexors and extensors. Where trauma or nerve injury do not allow the choice of a natural pair, then the training may be more difficult and may take more time to develop. Some electric prostheses use the muscle co-contraction to perform a particular function. In the Utah arm, this unlocks the elbow, and in the Pro Control, it switches between hand and wrist functions. A co-contraction requires a quick, simultaneous contraction of both control muscles without much strength of signal required. Think of it like snapping the fingers. A quick, light, both muscle function together action. The muscles must then relax after the co-contraction. And finally, the selection and initial training can be considered to be completed and the fitting proceed when the client can tolerate a 1-hour training session and is consistently generating sufficient signal to operate the prosthesis in at least the basic functions, such as opening and closing of the hand, bending and extending the elbow. Ask the prosthetist for the minimum signal required to operate the system of choice. With the transhumeral amputee, you're ideally looking for agonist-antagonist relationship in 2 different muscle sites. The most common muscle sites tapped into are the biceps and the triceps muscle. Bob's situation is that he has had a pectoralis major graft to the anterior arm. So that muscle is now located in the site where he would typically find a biceps and he would actually be contracting the biceps. But in terms of looking for a site on his arm, the first thing I'm going to do is put this electrode as distal as possible on the front of his arm. And Bob, I'm going to ask you to look at the MyoLab and you're going to look at the needle. You're going to think about flexing your elbow. And before you do it on the right arm, on your left arm, what I want you to do is flex that elbow. Not your wrist, you're going to raise your whole arm and bend your elbow. Okay. And as you do that, the muscle that's operating that motion of the joint is your biceps. Mm-hmm. If I added resistance to that, mm-hmm. you would feel a stronger contraction. Okay? So as you're trying to locate that muscle here, I'm going to ask you to bend the elbow on the left side. And you're going to imagine bending your elbow on the right. So what we're first going to do is try to find a biceps contraction on Bob's extremity. Okay, so what I want you to do is flex both elbows and see if you can get the dial on channel A to move up. Okay, as he works with bicep, you get a little flicker of motion. It's hard to identify whether it is in actuality the biceps muscle. Okay, relax for a minute. As I move more proximal now on the remnant limb, I want you to perform the same motion. You're going to try to flex both elbows. You're going to see if you can raise that needle. Okay, relax, Bob. I'm going to move a little more proximal. And now a portion of my electrode is over his graft site. If you were to activate your pectoralis major muscle, the way to do that on both sides is to think about squeezing your, bringing your shoulders in towards the middle of your body. Try doing that on your left side. And you're going to squeeze this muscle right here as you do that. Not so much bending the elbow, but rolling that shoulder in. Okay, I want you to try that now on both sides and see if you can get that needle to register. Okay, do you feel like you have a little more control over that?
A bit more.
Okay. I'm going to move a little more proximal on the arm so I'm over that muscle graft site a little bit more clearly. Try the same motion again.
It's easier.
Okay, so what we found is that in the anterior portion of his arm, he's actually working more with his pectoralis major than he is with his biceps, which would make sense based on the trauma to the arm and the reconstructive surgeries that have taken place. Amputees who have a shoulder disarticulation level of amputation, or the four-quarter level, as Esther does here, can frequently control the myoelectric prosthesis with an anterior and a posterior site, which are much, much more proximal than you have seen. It's most common to use an anterior site of a pectoralis muscle. And it's also very common to use a posterior site, if you could turn just slightly, Esther, of an infraspinatus muscle. One thing that's important to remember is that if an individual has suffered a traumatic amputation, you may not be certain of exactly what muscle fibers you're tapping into. More importantly, you're going to want to look for that agonist-antagonist relationship so that the individual can ultimately be trained to separate those two muscles and to use the relationship as such, which will allow the best operation of the electronics. So in Esther's situation here, we'd be looking at tapping into an anterior site. We want to be careful that we choose a site that allows the patient optimum control of the prosthesis, but it also needs to be a site that allows the prosthetist the ability to secure the electrodes in the socket and to keep excellent contact with the skin at all times. With an anterior site at this level, an Esther socket which will fit around and actually a little bit lower than that, she should be able to maintain pretty good contact site here. And then in the back, we're looking up a little bit higher into the area of the infraspinatus. As you recall, it's sort of a large flat muscle. The fibers run on a bit of an angle. And this would be an appropriate site, both of which can be placed with electrodes securely inside the socket. Now that we've identified the muscle sites that Esther will use to operate her electric prosthesis, we begin the concept of strengthening. It is important to address strengthening unique to each individual based on where those muscle sites are located. And I think it's a challenge to us to identify for the patient what range of motion or what concept of movement is necessary to identify those sites. Especially with someone in Esther's situation with the four-quarter amputation. She doesn't have the benefit of a clavicular motion or of the lever arm to work with, which is something that we all use when we're working on finding a muscle. If you want someone to work an anterior deltoid, there's a particular motion that you and I would use to find that muscle. And it's a little more difficult, perhaps, in your situation, Esther. Mm-hmm. Did you have any difficulty initially when you were being fit and sites were being tested to find the muscle that the prosthetist or the therapist were looking for?
It took a while. It took a while of working with both the therapist and myself.
There's a couple ways to approach strengthening. when you're dealing with remnant limbs. It's possible for an individual to use a cuff weight that you can Velcro or strap around the remnant limb, which allows them then to move their arm in various positions and strengthen those muscles. It's been my experience that the cuff weights are very difficult to maintain on the extremity. There is a technique where you can use a cuff weight and actually run a Velcro strapping over the shoulder, almost like a saddle, which will help to keep that weight on your arm. So if you're an individual who's used cuff weights in the past and you like that and you have them handy, we could certainly talk about strengthening using that equipment. Regardless of using cuff weights, there's another option for strengthening, which would involve using TheraBand. We know that TheraBand comes in different colors for different resistances. TheraBand can be utilized successfully. I believe it's most successful on the long above elbow amputee versus the short, in that you have better opportunity to secure the TheraBand around the distal end of the stump. It's possible to use a piece of TheraBand secured to a doorknob or a drawer that is shut in the kitchen or the office somewhere. You would, for example, wrap the TheraBand around the end of the stump. I can have you turn forward just a little bit. Perhaps this was hooked onto a door knob behind Bob, and I would ask Bob to work on shoulder flexion. You're going to work on bringing your arm forward in front of you, Bob. Okay. And you will be working against the resistance of the TheraBand. Okay? What you see here is a common problem with TheraBand. Come forward again. There tends to be this rolling effect that occurs, and we have successfully put a wider band around the TheraBand as it comes in contact with the body part. You can actually use a piece of fleece, or you can wrap a washcloth or some sort of a fabric around that to prevent the rolling. But Bob could work then on his anterior deltoids, his clavicular portion of his pec major to work on shoulder flexion motions, and the TheraBand would be providing the resistance. The same could be true with abduction of the arm. Bob could be taught to hold the TheraBand across his body and work on abduction motions. So Bob, if you will bring your arm out to the side and then come back down towards your trunk and relax. Do you feel resistance in this muscle as you do that?
Yeah, I sure do.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So what's happening is, and this would be based on as much tension as you wanted to apply, mm-hmm. you could work on strengthening that middle deltoid and that supraspinatus muscle just by working with a piece of TheraBand on your own. Whether or not you held onto it or attached it to a doorknob is up to you. Mm-hmm. Same concept in working on shoulder extension. If you'll turn to your left again, as Bob would work on bringing his arm behind him into extension, we would resist the motion with the TheraBand attached to a doorknob in front of Bob. TheraBand is an aid that can be assistive in strengthening. My preference at this point in terms of strengthening the remnant limb, which I find most successful, is working more with isometric exercises. Whether or not you're seeing the individual early following their amputation, and so you're starting on a very early pre-prosthetic intervention program, or whether you're seeing them down the road a bit, I find that the best way to assure some compliance on their part is to be equipment free and to get an individual working on an exercise program that they could do anywhere in anybody's home, on the job site. And so that's the reason I prefer isometric strengthening. Strengthening that can be done against the wall in your home, on the floor, on your bed. What you will do with an isometric strengthening exercise is you are increasing the resistance and the contraction of a muscle without getting a lot of motion in the joint. The easiest way to do that would be to instruct a person to stand at a wall. Let's work, if you will, let's have you face forward with your arm back against the wall. We don't have much room here. What I want to ask you to do, Bob, is to push your arm back as if you were extending your arm. And as you do that, the wall provides your resistance. And you can feel those same posterior deltoid muscles. He can feel his supraspinatus working against the resistance that the wall is providing. I would typically have you go through a series of 10 to 15 repetitions of all of the muscles that I think needed to be targeted for you, depending on where your weaknesses were. If you worked on abduction, bringing that arm out to the side, mm-hmm. you would turn so that the side of your arm is right up against that wall. You're in a comfortable stance. Your job is to think about elevating your arm out to the side. And in actuality, you're pushing into the wall. As long as that's not too uncomfortable on the distal end of your stump, If that was a situation you encountered, you would use a washcloth or a towel or a pillow or some sort of padding on the wall. And then when you do that motion, where do you feel resistance in your shoulder? What area of the shoulder do you feel muscles working?
On top and in the back.
Okay.
In that area.
So as he's working on abduction, we're resisting some of that middle deltoid and a little bit of the supraspinatus. In forward flexion to resist, rather than have a person work right into a wall, I would probably suggest that you stood in a doorway. Yeah. So you have a little open space to which to breathe next to you. And you could position your arm right in the door jamb itself and then work on your forward flexion motion. There, again, important reasons for separating, if you'll turn sideways, Bob. Muscles acting on the glenohumeral joint as well as muscles that act on the scapulothoracic joint. Work on your pectoralis muscles, work on latissimus dorsi, work on your supraspinatus, your middle posterior and anterior deltoid muscles. Depending on how long that limb is, you certainly will want to work on biceps and triceps, but again, it's difficult to do an isometric or to add a weight in any sort of isokinetic manner. What you will need then to do is work on the individual imitating isometric contraction, providing their own resistance. For example, I want you to imagine flexing your elbow. And if you recall, in Bob's situation, he uses his tricep to do that. So I want you to imagine tensing up your tricep, which for you means bending an elbow. And if you can see, Bob is able to get a pretty strong contraction just identifying what muscle he needs to work on. In terms of strengthening trunk muscles, we already talked about the pectoralis muscles being an important one. It works on the front part of the shoulder, and we talked about deltoids and those muscles that function on the superior portion of the scapula. As we talked about in range of motion, if I could have you turn around one more time, when you're really working with an individual on trunk muscles, so much of what you're working with are your back, your paraspinal muscles, all those muscles that attach around that shoulder blade, and most importantly, those that attach at the lower end. When we talked about range of motion, we had Bob practice depressing his shoulder blades. And in so doing, with some cueing from me, he was able to feel his back muscles pull his shoulder blades down as opposed to him working the front of his body only. One nice way to work on strengthening your paraspinals and a little bit of your lat is to work on scapular depression. So if you will, for me, Bob, on both sides, practice pulling those shoulder blades down. It's a very subtle motion. And relax for a moment. Okay, pull them down again, nice and tight. You can see the increased muscle bulk, and you can watch the contraction of the muscles around the inferior border of that scapula. It's important to help an individual learn that subtle tension and to get a sense of what that feels like. If you did this about 5 times in a row for me, tell me if you feel any fatigue in here. You're going to pull down, 2, 3, and relax. And you're going to pull down with quite a bit of effort and relax.
Yeah, I do feel a little bit of fatigue.
And it's just really isolating some very small muscles that we don't typically think about as individual muscles. Thanks, Bob. The general remaining trunk muscles can be strengthened through general aerobic activity, general stretching and strengthening, and normal recreational activity actually in your individual life. There aren't very many special therapeutic techniques that we need to incorporate to work on general trunk strengthening. The activity that comes to mind most for an individual who needed to really focus on generalized strengthening would be some swimming, getting a person in a pool and working on some general supported but resistive motion through the water as the medium. It's ultimately the goal of ourselves as well as the prosthetist and certainly of the patient to be able to don and doff their prosthesis independently. Typically, the prosthetist will be initiating this education as they're in the process of fitting. It will be helpful for each of us to learn the style that our client uses and to offer strategies and alterations as necessary. In the transradial amputee, such as Red, there's usually quite an ease in terms of donning the prosthesis because of the supracondylar design of the socket. as it basically is molded around the medial and lateral condyles of the humerus. It's frequently their ability to simply slip into the socket. You will notice that a patient may have to wait up to a minute's period of time before they establish good contact with the electrodes and before the electrodes are responsive to their muscle sites. This can be speeded up by moistening the electrodes with a little water prior to inserting the limb into the socket, or else waiting for some of the perspiration to build up to establish that contact. As Red's going to demonstrate for us here, his prosthetist has designed a socket which is facilitated in terms of donning by use of a sock. And if we can have you show us how you use this sock and perhaps the purpose of this attachment.
Okay.
How high up do you pull your sock?
Just right above the elbow here.
Okay.
Or up kind of, whatever you call it. I slide this fitting, the weight, through the hole and pull it. I usually set the end of the hand up against something so I make sure I don't pull the prosthesis off. I'm careful not to jerk it, because if I pull it too fast, it won't get the good connection I need.
Very nice. So the purpose of this weight was just to help you guide it through the,
right.
the hole. And you're ready to go.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Frequently what I do when I first engage with a client is to ask, can you put your arm on by yourself, yes or no? And also, can you demonstrate for me how you do that? And then if I'm identifying that there are some problems, I will consult with the prosthetist, talk it over, talk about some options, talk about why we may want to avoid the use of lotions and powders, whether or not we need to use those, and kind of move on from there to give the client some feedback. Why don't you demonstrate for us using your pull sock and donning your prosthetic arm?
All righty.
Can you tell us what's hanging off the bottom of your pull sock?
Well, a string with just it's just a little chain on here. I find that it finds the hole real quickly to have a little weight down there at the end of the string. And I have also found that if I do not position this saddle completely up on top before I pull the sock out, it helps. Sometimes it's really tough to get out, and I lift my arm just a bit to help the sock get started. And as it gets started, well, then I do keep my arm down in there tight, and it will just continue to pull it all the way in. Once it's in, then I go ahead and place the saddle part where it goes.
And then tighten up your harness.
And then tighten up the harness here. Mm-hmm.
The frame-type socket used by the shoulder amputee is actually easier for the patient to don themselves. Unfortunately, it can be a little bit heavier for them to wear and a little bit less comfortable. This is the frame type socket that Esther will use. When Esther applies the prosthesis to the arm, she has a harnessing system with two straps that come across the chest. This top strap will fit underneath the left axilla, and then this lower strap comes across on an angle down towards the lower part of her chest. It is very important that the socket be donned in the same manner each time. It needs to be in the exact same position each time so that good electrode contact with the muscle site is maintained. One of the things that is common with this higher level of amputee, and in particular with the socket itself, is that it's very difficult to maintain electrode contact at all times. Esther, have you ever had difficulty with loss of electrode contact when you're wearing your prosthesis?
When I'm leaning back in my recliner, it shifts, and then I can't use it. If I have it on, it goes crazy.
Meaning that you lose some electrode contact somewhere because of the change in position.
Mm-hmm.
And how does that affect what you're doing functionally?
I just turn it off and do what I'm, like cross-stitching or what have you.
Okay. And then when you're back in a more upright position, you find that you have good electrode contact with this socket.
Yeah, it returns to normal like it should.
Mm-hmm. If there are difficulties with loss of electrode contact and you believe it's something related to socket design, it would be appropriate to discuss that with the prosthetist. In an electric prosthesis, you should be familiar with the battery and the charger system utilized. The prosthetist fitting the patient with the prosthesis may instruct you in the appropriate battery and the charging system necessary. For example, the Utah arm utilizes a 12-volt rechargeable battery, which fits into the back of the elbow, clicks into place, and is secured with the tab. To remove the battery, you raise up on the tab and slide the battery out of the compartment. This battery is recharged in this motion control charger. When the battery is secure in the charger and the indicator light is on, as with most chargers, you then are aware of the fact that the battery is receiving power for recharging. The recharging period of this particular unit is 18 to 24 hours. A fast charger may be available for your system, which will charge a battery in 1 to 2 hours' time. It is important when considering the use of rechargeable batteries that you'll get the best result of the prosthesis if you allow the battery to fully drain prior to recharging. It's commonly seen in electric prosthesis that the function of the arm slows when the battery is running low, and it's therefore important, and we have indicated this in the troubleshooting section, that the first and foremost thing that you do is check that the battery is fully charged. In the Utah Pro Control, a typical 6-volt rechargeable battery in a compartment such as this is fit into the forearm piece. And it is recharged in this type of a Autobach recharger. It is possible to use a 9-volt disposable battery in the Utah Pro Control. This can simply be disposed of and you can replace it with a store-bought 9-volt battery. When you're ready to begin using the prosthesis, you then need to remind the client that you're progressing from simple tasks into more complex tasks and then into daily living tasks. The first thing that we're going to talk about with Red in his transradial amputation and his below elbow prosthesis then is the basic function of the prosthesis. You're positioned here with the hand. Could you demonstrate for us how you turn the hand on, how you activate the power to the hand?
Yeah, there's a little button inside the wrist right here, and you just push it on.
Okay.
It's on.
So you review their ability to turn on their electric device. We're going to work on basic control of your prosthesis. At this point, you have the control of hand function as well as wrist function.
Right.
In order to work with hand function, the first thing we're going to talk about is basically how do you open and close the hand. What muscle are you using to close your hand?
The same muscle as if my hand was still here. I just open my wrist, and the muscle's on the side of my forearm.
Mm-hmm.
That's opening.
Okay. So Red's using his wrist extensors to open the hand, and he's using his wrist flexors to close the hand. Let me see you close the hand fully and open the hand fully. Do that about 3 times for me. Good. Okay, now I want you to open the hand in 5 different increments to full open.
Okay, well, let me close it all the way first, okay?
Nice. And the same thing closing.
It tends to close a little bit easier. It kind of coasts sometimes all the way shut.
Which would be a function of his ability to control that muscle contraction. So you work on full range of motion, you work on partial range of motion. The next thing we'll work on is speed. I'm going to ask you to open the hand slowly. Nice. And close the hand slowly. Okay, one more time. And close. Nice. So when you're working with control, you don't want to simply instruct the below elbow amputee in how do you open and close, but how do you control that, and also how do you separate those two muscles. It's important for you, Red, to learn how much control you truly have of your wrist flexors, whether it's speed or force of contraction, as well as how much control he has of the extensors. The more specific you can work on control of those muscle sites, the more optimal the hand will function. Okay, besides on and off of the hand and the opening and closing of the hand, you also have the ability with that proportional control then to learn how slowly and how tightly you need to grip or pinch something, and then how quickly, slowly, or freely you need to let go of that. Let's introduce also the concept of a greifer, which is made by Ottobock, and it's a separate terminal device that's used for more rugged activities. Go ahead and turn your hand off, and let me have you explain to the therapist how you take the hand off and interchange the greifer.
All it takes is a full 360 of the hand, and it just pops right off.
Called a quick disconnect.
And to put it back on, the greifer or the hand, it's just a quick, nice little snug push until it clicks, and then it's on. It's ready to go.
Okay. Is there an on and off switch to the greifer?
Yes, it's this switch right here. It also acts as a lock, too, because it will turn either way. If I want to lock it right there, it won't turn on or off either. I mean, it won't operate because it's off right now.
Okay, so you can lock the amount of deviation.
Go around like this.
Okay.
It just won't open and close when its lock is on.
Do you find yourself using the greifer in your daily activities?
I'd say about 50%. The hand, mainly for cosmetic and appearance reasons, mm-hmm. like when I'm at school or outside and going to restaurants or something. And this I use for around the house a lot.
Also, I think another advantage that you mentioned is that he can work with rough activities, things that may potentially stain the glove of the hand. You also have a closer proximity to a surface. If you were to grasp this item off the table, he's got a completely different prehensile ability with the greifer than he does with the hand. So the important point is that they're interchangeable, and then you choose in your daily life to which of the two terminal devices you prefer.
Right.
Okay, very nice. Why don't I go ahead and have you put the hand back on the arm. And we're going to go through the next phase of training, which is beyond learning basic control. The next thing you moved into is how to use that control in a more natural manner. For example, one of the first things that you're going to work with in training a client, once they've mastered the ability, I would say about 80% of the time, to respond to your commands to open and close, quickly, slowly, partial range, you then move into the concept of maintained grasp. What I'm going to ask you to do at this point is to work on some maintained grasp using your prosthesis to stabilize each of these jars and remove the lids with your left hand.
Okay.
So what Red's demonstrating for us is the ability to elicit enough EMG signal to close the hand and to maintain that amount. Sure. To maintain that amount of contraction while he's working with another aspect of the task with his left hand.
Has a good firm grip. I can tighten it really tight if I wanted to.
Okay. Would you typically use your hand for an activity like this at home, or would you use the greifer?
I'd probably use the greifer or something like this.
Okay. So various sizes, and he's got excellent ability to maintain his grasp even on the larger jar. Another example of maintaining grasp, why don't you go ahead and stand up for this. You're making chocolate chip cookies, and you got to stir them up. So give me an example of how you could incorporate your prosthesis into that activity.
Okay. I'll hold the bowl right here. Stir it up.
Okay, basically using the hand as a stabilizer, maintaining enough hold that things aren't slipping around.
Right.
Okay. Okay, very good. This next activity would most optimally be done at a countertop. But let's go ahead and try sitting, and then if that doesn't work, we can shift position.
Okay.
Another real common activity that requires maintained grasp with a little more skill would be working in the kitchen. Being able to stabilize a piece of food, if you will, and practice peeling. Or not practice peeling, but actually peel the food. You can choose either one of these that works best in your left hand. It's important to note that Red was right dominant prior to his injury. Let's see you work on peeling a couple skins off that potato.
Okay, I'd probably want to use the grifter
for
something like this. I might peel my skin off.
There are adapted cutting boards that we're all familiar with, and the adapted cutting board is designed with usually two nails and sometimes more than two nails run through the bottom. Many of them also have a corner compartment, an enlargement, if you will, to help stabilize objects. And many times, an individual is provided with an adapted cutting board as they're learning to become a unilateral individual. But I found that it's also a very worthwhile adaptation in the home setting, even when working with their prosthesis, to assist them in stabilizing. Nice job. He's showing us that he doesn't need the adapted cutting board. So he's got good prehension ability, nice control, and he's able to work with his left hand, the prosthesis being a stabilizer.
Am I good?
Beautiful.
Want to peel the whole thing?
No, it's fine. Thank you.
Got some french fries.
Okay, so we've demonstrated for you some of the maintained grasp activities. They are functional activities in terms of having application to a person's lifestyle, but in a clinic setting, the most that you can do is simulate some of these activities. Once you've helped an individual master the concept of maintained grasp, then you move into the next more complex phase, which is repetitive grasp and release. Drying dishes, this is an example of constantly repositioning the terminal device and grasping in another position. So it's repetitive in nature. Another example of this might be polishing a shoe. You may feel more comfortable standing for this activity, but what I'm going to ask you to do is apply some shoe polish to this shoe using your grifter, if that's your choice, to repeatedly reposition the shoe.
Okay.
Nice job. Thank you. So what he was involved in is repeated grasp and release using the terminal device. Another activity which you may find common in your clinic setting would be utilizing something like a checkerboard or blocks of any kind, where the request here then becomes, I would like you to practice picking each one of these up around the block and setting it on the board. This may seem a more mundane, repetitive activity, but the purpose is to help the individual learn that concept of grasp and release and to repeat that function. Whether it's a pegboard, moving something from point A to point B doesn't really matter. The nature of it is to encourage repeated grasp and release. So you have about 10 blocks here, if I can have you set them on this board using your grifter.
On the side like this?
Mm-hmm. Following repetitive grasp and release activities, you're then going to work on the whole concept of pressure control. And the beauty of the Pro Control is that it is proportional control. It's important to help the client understand that they have the ability to control the force with which they close or open their terminal device. For example, I'm going to ask you to put the hand on and interchange with the grifter so that we can work on some daily activities that would require you to use pressure control. So if you'll go ahead and switch that, I'm going to have you work specifically on cutting something. But not the potato. Let's work with a tomato. Okay, what I'd like you to do is to stabilize the tomato with your prosthetic hand and practice slicing that tomato. Nice job. Yeah. Cut us a few slices?
Yeah.
Now, do you find it difficult to maintain the control that you have without causing a tighter grasp?
No.
Very nice. Okay, let's try another activity. Similar to something you do in the kitchen. Here's a hard-boiled egg. See if you can demonstrate holding that egg and peeling once you've made some cracks in it.
Okay.
There's a trick to peeling eggs if you roll them after you crack them.
Oh, really?
Yeah, skins come off a little easier. Beautiful job. Nice job.
Again?
Yeah, it's beautiful. Thank you. Now, another activity that you could work on, should you have come to your therapy clinic in the morning and forgotten to boil the egg, another kind of repetitive and more mundane task, but also teaches the client in a less threatening situation because it is not a, quote, functional activity, would be to have them work with various dimensions of sponge soaked in water. What I'm going to ask you to do is the same thing, is to practice your ability to control your grip or your pinch by picking up a sponge without letting any water squeeze out of the sponge.
Okay.
Okay? So let's try that a couple times here on the table. And set that down. Use a little more force this time and see what happens. Do you get any sense of feedback from the activity that you've squoze harder than you needed to?
Not really any feedback with a sponge.
Other than just the visual sign of it. So that's another activity that could be useful helping to develop and refine proportional control. Your prosthesis does have an electric wrist, is that correct, Rick?
Yes.
Okay. Can you demonstrate for us how that wrist operates?
Yes. To open and close, I just use each side individually, and then when I want the wrist rotator, I co-contract, and I just give it a quick, like as if my hand was still there, I just give it a quick jolt like that, and it switches over to the wrist, and then again, to get it back to the hand, open and close, just a quick jolt back and forth.
So you're using a co-contraction of both muscles to switch to the hand, and then you have to repeat the same co-contraction to go back to the wrist.
Yes.
What is it you think of when you say a quick jolt? Do you think about making a fist, pointing a finger, moving
making
your wrist?
Making a fist, like just like that real quick.
Okay.
Or flexing my forearm
okay.
real fast.
Co-contraction is responsive to the speed of contraction of both muscles as opposed to the amount of force that is exerted. It's frequent in your training that if an individual is having difficulty with co-contraction, they will move into greater work or effort, they will try to contract harder. And you may have experienced that when you were first learning. But as they contract harder, they're actually working against themselves. So it's the speed of contraction. Okay, let's work with your prosthesis now in using that concept of prepositioning to engage in a few activities. This will give us a very nice example of how Red will be able to use that wrist rotator to optimally position the hand or the greifer for his task. Those individuals who are wearing electric prostheses that do not have an electric wrist incorporated into them will need to do a manual preposition of the wrist. One example I'm going to ask you to do, can you go ahead and remove your wallet from your pocket and take a few bills out of your wallet?
Mm-hmm. I really didn't need to use my wrist there.
Okay, he had a very subtle adjustment, though, to get your hand in a nice position. Nice job. You had to think a little bit about what the best position was for holding that object so that you can then perform.
It was already in the position I would have. And if it was like this already, then I would have had to, you know, switch it over like this.
Okay. Good example. What if I asked you to grasp the wallet
off the table.
Then I would probably either this way, backhand.
Mm-hmm. And that's actually an important concept for prepositioning, that the hand does have the ability to rotate that far around. And then to set the wallet down.
Send it down the other way.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Okay. Another concept of prepositioning that's very valuable is when you're dealing with a bimanual task. You have to use both hands now. What I'm going to ask you to do is to pick up three or four objects from the table and set them on this tray. Then I'd like you to grasp the tray and stand up and set it on the counter behind you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you can choose any objects here and set them on the tray. Okay, can you pick up an object in each hand and set them on the tray?
Yeah, I can. Go for the egg. It's easier. Is that enough?
Okay. Now I'm going to ask you to grasp the tray and set it on this counter behind you. And if you come back and have a seat. There's an area of prepositioning that comes later on in training. As an individual has gone through basic control functions and learned to start incorporating the prosthesis, it's very common and helpful to alert an individual into normal movement patterns of the body. When someone sits down and rests their hands in their lap, the ability to incorporate that movement into your position. If Red was to stand up from his chair, would he stand up and relax the hand in any one particular position over another? And so it's important to think about that as you're approaching a task. You complete the task in what would be a natural pattern to rest in.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, go ahead and put the Greifer on. I'm going to have you engage in another activity that I believe you would probably use the Greifer for more so than the hand. And this is a more mechanical activity. I'm going to ask Red to do a little hammering for us. What I'd like you to do is to put in two nails into the board, one of the small and one of the large nails. Go ahead and hammer them right into this piece of wood.
The reason why I like this Greifer, it's a lot more versatile. I can pick up smaller stuff with
mm-hmm.
it.
Okay, I'm going to ask you to actually put the hand on and interchange with the Greifer at this point. Now, because you own the Greifer, it's highly unlikely that Red would actually use his hand for this activity, but for the sake of demonstration, what I'd like to emphasize is that some individuals that don't have a Greifer need to be more particular about prepositioning when they're working with the hand. Go ahead and grasp one of the small nails with your hand and hammer it into the board. Another concept of prepositioning that we'd like to emphasize is that Red does have full shoulder range of motion. You certainly and always want to encourage the client to use whatever normal postures that they have to get as close to their object or their task as possible, rather than to strictly rely on function with their prosthesis. In summary, then, what we have demonstrated for you is the progression of patient training. We've gone from basic functional operation of the prosthesis. You review that with the client prior to actually engaging in any activities. We sometimes refer to that as control training. Then you move into purposeful activities which are goal-oriented, but that don't have a significant importance to the client. And the reason that you do that next level of working with maintained grasp and release, moving in different planes of motion, is to help a client understand the function of their prosthesis, but it isn't in such a pressurized manner that they may feel some discomfort if they fail at a task. That is often referred to as use training. And then finally, you move into your functional training, or actually the activities that are very important to your client's daily living. You want to tap into their goals, because their goals are really the only goals that matter in terms of their ability to function with their prosthesis in their daily life. Another option for the below elbow amputee is a myoelectric hand that operates with a digital controller, which is what Rick is wearing. He is using wrist extensors to open the hand and wrist flexors to close the hand. In his particular system, once he generates a muscle contraction that exceeds the threshold that is preset, then the electrodes turn the motor and drive the hand in the appropriate direction. When he relaxes the muscle below that set threshold, then the motor will indicate to the hand to stop motion. Rick, go ahead and show us your operation of the prosthesis, opening and closing the hand.
To open the hand, all I'm doing is flexing a muscle group here, my extensor muscles, and when the signal from the muscle exceeds the threshold of the electrode, the hand begins to run in open mode. When I want to close it, I have just flexed the flexor muscle here, and the hand will run closed.
Okay. Let me have you pick up a couple activities then. A couple objects, excuse me, off the table.
Small things like coins, pins, beads, things of that nature on a tabletop, I have to pull to the edge of the tabletop in order to get a good grip on them, picking them up. But bigger objects are simple to pick up, especially if they have a little bit of surface tack to them, or if they stick up from the surface a little bit. Any larger objects like this piece of wood and other things are easy to pick up because they stick up off the tabletop enough.
Do you have any difficulty determining how much pressure to apply to the object when you pick it up?
It takes a certain amount of thought, but down here where the piece of wood is solid, it doesn't matter how much force I use. But in an area like this where it's fairly delicate, I have to be certain. I have to be careful that I close the hand in a place where I want to hold it, and relax the muscle so that the hand will stop running at a grip force that's adequate enough to stabilize the piece.
Okay. Show us how you do some whittling on that piece of wood.
What I'm doing here is just carving this little helix in here, and it requires opening up the slot a little bit as you go, and then thinning away or paring away at the edge of the piece to make it look more delicate than it actually is.
This is an excellent example of an activity that requires frequent repositioning of the hand.
Right.
So it's excellent in terms of training, and certainly you have an interest in that area, but to help an individual engage in an activity that requires a lot of repositioning, and therefore they get to practice prepositioning as well.
A lot. Yeah.
A lot.
And the more you use the device, the better you get with it, and the more ways you find out that it can be used. Mm-hmm. I use the tacky surface of the glove a lot to do things. I manipulate objects on tabletops. I push or use that friction to carve against and things of that nature. So the nature of the surface of the glove is part of the tool.
Rick has certainly learned multiple skills and is very adept at functioning with his myoelectric hand. You may encounter individuals who have been long-term amputees who have used different appliances, different prosthesis design. When they come to you and possibly are fit with a new design, it is important that you take them through all stages of training so that they learn how to operate that additional or different prosthesis from the beginning through the entire stage of rehab. Rick, show us how you remove the prosthesis.
Okay. I'm a wrist disarticulation level amputee, and so I have my complete forearm with the two styloids on the end, these bony prominences just below where my watch is. So I'm suspended on those. And so I have a Velcro release here that I allow some windows to open up with. And then when I pull out, the broad end of my arm just comes through a expanding portion of the socket.
I notice you're wearing a Band-Aid on the end of that radius.
There's a little rough spot on the inside of my socket here, mm-hmm. and rather than allow it to rub a sore into the surface of my skin, I'm putting this on here until I can repair that, mm-hmm. so to protect myself.
Mm-hmm. Problems that an individual might have with fit can become exponentially greater, so it's important that we talk with them about inspecting their skin frequently and caring for those spots as immediately as possible.
Yeah, hygiene and being watching for those kinds mm-hmm. of things to take care of yourself before it becomes a problem is real important. If I hadn't paid attention to this, I could have worn a small hole in the surface of my skin, something that a non-amputee wouldn't worry about at all. But I have to, because the environment inside the socket will cause that to get worse. Mm-hmm. Then I will not be able to wear my prosthesis for a while until it heals, and that's really inconvenient for me.
Good point. In terms of donning the prosthesis, do you use anything on the arm? Do you use lotions?
Not really.
Donning socks of any kind?
I just push in, but before I put it on, I like to put some moisture on the electrode sites so that I have immediate good control when I get into the prosthesis. It requires a little bit of moisture to aid the conduction of this tiny signal from the surface of my skin to the electrodes themselves.
Okay.
So I just put a couple of drops of water here and then push in and tighten my strap down. And now I'm ready to go.
Nice. I did notice that you brought a liner sock. What is the application of this?
I wear a sleeve like this to help keep the tissue in the socket and against the electrodes. And this is just a silicone type material that's impregnated into this fabric sleeve. And I pull this on and pull it up to the brim of the prosthesis. And wear it from the elbow right down onto the plastic laminate itself. And this pulls the tissue or holds it down mm-hmm. inside the socket. So I maintain good electrode contact, I have good comfort and range of motion is maintained, and I keep good control, which is the issue with me.
That's a nice option. And control is the most important aspect of the myoelectric prosthesis.
Mm-hmm. It's the simplicity.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Most typically, on an above elbow amputee with existing biceps and triceps musculature, the biceps is utilized to flex the elbow and to close the terminal device, in this case, the electric hand. And the triceps is most commonly used to open the terminal device and also to extend the elbow. In Bob's situation, his muscles are altered in that his triceps initially was a much stronger muscle and he had better control of that. So he is using his triceps muscle behind the arm to close the terminal device as well as to flex his elbow. Let's originally work with the hand. In terms of controlling the hand, let me just have you work on opening the hand to its full range. Good. And I want you to close the hand fully. Maybe do about 5 repetitions of that. Nice. And what muscle are you using to open that hand?
The bicep opens the hand and my tricep closes it.
Okay. In terms of controlling the hand and then using it to engage in an activity, we're going to run through a sequence of some common applications. The first thing we're going to look at is Bob's ability to maintain grasp on an object. That's most important when you consider the prosthesis as an assist. For example, Bob, I'm going to have you take the lid off of this glass jar. Very nice. So you're able to maintain your grip.
Mm-hmm.
To maintain the grip, are you maintaining contraction of your muscle?
No, I just use the bicep to close the hand and then relax. I don't have to continue to flex to hold on to it.
Okay, very good. Let's try a different size object that also requires you to maintain grasp. I'll have you open this small childproof medicine lid. Very nice. What you're noticing is that the hand does have enough power in its pinch ability to stabilize and to hold a pretty strong grasp on something that requires quite a bit of force to manipulate. To work on repetitive grasp and release would be your next segment. Once the individual has understood the basic control of the hand and is able to maintain grasp using the hand as an assist, then you're going to move them on to practicing different sizes of grasp and release. The next stage would be to practice that same control, but to see how well the individual can operate the prosthesis at different levels. Working at a table height is the most common way each of us will be working with our clients in the clinic setting. I will point out an important fact at this point, which is when you're working at a table surface, in a standard chair and a standard table height, the individual wearing the prosthesis would be sitting at a much lower level. So Bob would be sitting at my level. He would need to have his prosthesis elbow flexed fully, or at least at 90 degrees, to work at the surface. What you will discover is it's more advantageous to functioning with control of the hand because of the nature of its closing and opening pattern to be slightly above the table height or the surface height you're working on. So when you're working with a client in sitting, it's ideal to either work with an adjustable height chair or a stool. When an individual is back home, to have them work on raising the surface of their stool or their chair in their home setting. If you're working at a counter height and an individual is standing above the table or the counter, then it's not such an issue. They're typically above their surface. In terms of working now at different levels, what I'm going to have you do is a sort of a repetitive task in standing. I'm going to ask you to come to this back wall here with me. What I've done is put a strip of Velcro on the wall, and I'm going to ask you to take a checker which has the opposing Velcro surface, and I'm going to ask you with your right prosthesis to practice putting the Velcro. You can start high or low, it doesn't matter, but I'd like you to put the checkers on the Velcro at various heights. The main thing we're looking at is how well you can control open and close of your hand at different levels. Mm-hmm. Okay? So go ahead and pick one up and start working either, again, higher or lower, whatever your pleasure is. The important thing to pay attention to here is Bob's ability to determine which part of the hand function is easier and more difficult depending on surfaces. Then what you do is you help a person problem solve. If they needed to work at a level above the shoulder or the head and they were having more difficulty closing, they may need to learn to assist with their sound arm in that particular task. Mm-hmm. What's the highest that you can reach and successfully let go?
Well, let's see here, Denise, what it'd be. It's letting go.
Okay, so you, yes. You have the closure down, but it's a little more difficult to open.
Yeah, it is up that high.
Okay, there you got a little opening. So you're still, though, above shoulder height, which is really quite a functional range.
Yeah.
Whether you were taking items out of a cupboard at home, you may still need a stool to stand on, but you at least have the ability to function with the hand above shoulder height, which is a nice range of motion. Mm-hmm. Do you have any difficulty opening or controlling the terminal device down low?
In other words,
if you had to extend your arm fully,
okay. No, down low is really quite easy for me.
And typically that would be because the muscles involved in controlling are in a more relaxed and a natural symmetrical position. Okay, very nice. Have a seat. So you've worked with controlling the hand in different sizes of objects as well as in different positions. Both help you to acquire the practice in terms of operating the hand. The beauty of the hand is that it does have the ability to respond to various positions, and the user has the ability to control how wide or how narrowly they open and close the terminal device. In terms of some fine motor ability with that hand, quite naturally, the prosthetic hand becomes the assistive hand, the holding, the stabilizing tool. It would be somewhat unusual for an individual to be functioning with fine motor tasks with the prosthesis. But many times you're involved in small activities that still require some stability, and it's a very small item. So in that sense, you're looking at working with fine motor skills. I don't know that Bob is much of a seamstress, at least probably not. Well, he may mend his own clothing, I don't know.
Once in a while.
Okay, I'm going to ask you to try to thread a needle. You decide which would be the easier, to stabilize the needle or to stabilize the thread as you approach the task.
I would probably choose to stabilize the needle with this hand, with the prosthetic hand, and use my good hand to turn this so I can see it.
There's much more subtle motion, sensory feedback, and control with the sound hand. So here you see a very nice example of a fine motor task with the prosthesis being used as the stabilizer. Another example might be to have an individual practice threading some beads, large and small beads. Again, it's a repetitive task, but it allows that individual to figure out where is the best place for me to function with my prosthesis and to function with the hand in terms of stabilizing. Let me ask you to open this container and remove, there appears to be five little screwdrivers in there. Let me have you open the container and remove the screwdrivers.
I've stabilized the box with a prosthetic hand. And again, I'd probably just stabilize that and pick out each little individual screwdriver.
If you had to use that individual screwdriver to work on a particular item, again, it's a fine motor task. The prosthesis would most likely stabilize the object.
It would, yeah.
So that he could use the screwdriver with the left.
Yeah.
Okay, very nice. At this point, we're going to move into elbow function with Bob's prosthesis. The elbow is also controlled by the same muscles that control the terminal device, in his case, the electric hand. Again, if you recall, biceps typically flexes the elbow, triceps typically extends the elbow. But again, each individual wearer has their prosthesis fit to them and their control system fit to them so that they optimally function. In Bob's situation, he is using his triceps muscle to flex that elbow and his biceps to extend.
Okay.
If I can have you stand for a minute, it might be a little bit easier to see this function.
Okay.
What I'd like you to do is actually the more difficult of all elbow functions. The Utah arm requires a co-contraction, which is a very rapid and even firing of the two control muscles to unlock an elbow joint. It isn't the force of contraction of that biceps or triceps muscle, rather it is the speed with which both contract simultaneously. Frequently, some techniques might be having an individual imagine snapping their fingers. It's that sort of a quick contraction of a couple muscles. Sometimes making a quick fist will cause those muscles to fire. Some people do well with a quick flick of the elbow, almost as if they were throwing their arm out to the side. I've had other individuals describe if they think about twisting their arm, whether it's their forearm or their shoulder. The concept is that it's a very quick motion. In your experience, do you use any of those analogies to help you find this ability?
You know, I probably would think that move my elbow out a bit. I'm not really aware of that until you said that, but I think I would think of using my elbow to get the both to work at the same time.
Do you remember when you were first fit with your arm and practiced this motion? Did any of those strategies work for you better than others?
No, it took a little while. That was a frustrating part of working the arm, is to get this elbow to unlock.
Okay. Frequently, the person in training feels that if they just try harder, I'll just try harder and I'll make it work. And unfortunately, as they try harder, they're getting a stronger contraction, but they're actually slowing down their rate. And it really is, the key here is the speed. Demonstrate, if you can, your co-contraction, which will unlock your elbow. Okay, and bring your arm back up and let it lock. And can you demonstrate that about 5 times with your elbow in different positions? Very nice. You may be able to hear the clicking of the elbow locking. If you weren't looking at your arm, mm-hmm. If you were looking at the table, how would you know that you had successfully unlocked that elbow?
The sound definitely helps a lot. If I wear clothing and that sound is muffled, and I really didn't see that, see the hand, it would be a little difficult to really know. I feel it when it comes all the way down. Mm-hmm. I feel a little bit of a movement in my socket, so I would know that it has come down.
So you would you say that you truly rely on the sound?
The sound or sight.
Okay.
But yeah.
Okay.
Or a combination, yeah.
The other sound that you may or may not be hearing as you watch Bob do this is the little whir of the motor. Mm-hmm. If you go ahead and lock your elbow for us, and as you attempt to unlock, just prior to that click, you'll hear the motor working, okay? That tells me when I'm in the process of training, and it helps me initially to help an individual understand that they're close. They actually hear the motor whir, and so they know they're pretty close to getting the appropriate contraction or the appropriate speed, which will then cause the unlock. If they're trying and trying and there's no sound of a motor, then it's time to pause, regroup, and try to find that contraction again. Okay, so that's a nice example. You do really, really well with co-contraction. And as you mentioned, it does take some practice. It's a difficult concept. So because of that, what has been developed is what's called a lock override button, which is, if you can look at the side of Bob's arm here, at the elbow, there's this little black button. The lock override button, as the name implies, if you push that button, then you eliminate the need to use co-contraction to unlock the elbow. So for example, go ahead and unlock your elbow naturally and flex your elbow and allow it to lock. This time I want you to practice following my target. My hand would be your target, and I want you to follow that. If an individual was working on following this target and they were having some difficulty at one particular point, shifting gears or moving quickly enough, as you heard and saw, Bob's elbow locked into place. In training sometimes, even though you can adjust the time for that elbow to lock internally, you can slow that time down or speed that time up in terms of functional use, it still sometimes becomes an interference during active use. I want you to now push the lock override button, which will eliminate that locking ability, and then we'll practice following the target. So as Bob, as you are struggling perhaps to have control over that elbow, and you're trying to work with something higher and lower and get your arm positioned, you don't have to worry necessarily about if you're pausing, your elbow will lock. So as you can notice, even as he's maintaining one position, his elbow is not locking. Okay, relax that arm. The only way to recycle or to then reactivate the internal ability of this elbow to lock would be to turn the arm off and on, and you can demonstrate that for us.
Up and then on.
When Bob turned the arm on, there was a small sound of the motor kicking back on, so he now knows, even if you weren't looking at your arm, that he has successfully reactivated the motor. And in so doing, now I want you to follow a target. We're going to pause right here. And he has reactivated the locking ability. Let's talk a little bit about the ability of the elbow to free swing. Free swing is a concept whereby the elbow is allowed with gravity to assist to relax in an extended position, and it doesn't lock at all. It essentially, with the individual relaxing their control muscle, the gravity assists the extension of the arm, and then the arm is allowed to sort of naturally swing to and fro. You don't end up with the situation of the elbow locking in any of those positions. And the key is that the control muscles need to be completely relaxed. Mm-hmm. I'm going to ask you to do a couple activities now that require you to work both systems. How about if I ask you to pick the box up that's on the floor behind that chair and set it on the chair? Why don't you take all the items on the table and load them in the box? Mm-hmm. And as you do that, think about, after grasping, unlocking that elbow and repositioning as you load that box up.
Okay.
Nice.
Really doing the elbow much, though.
And it's an example of what is considered to be functionally appropriate and some of the concepts that you're working on just in training. Frequently, when someone is first learning to operate their prosthesis, and you may remember this, you'll involve yourself in an activity, you work on the hand function, and wherever the elbow is resting, you'll do everything in your power to leave that elbow there. And we see a lot of compensation going on in pretty extreme postures of the body. I may see someone grasp an object and stand up, and they leave their elbow flexed here. And then when I ask them to set the object down, they will walk over and bend at the waist and set the object down, always maintaining the same position of the elbow. Your job as a therapist is to help cue them into trying to work with that arm as naturally as possible. So once they're maintaining grasp on an item, which they have accomplished, and they come to set it down, which you demonstrated pretty well, you unlock that elbow and you allow that more natural motion of the arm. And so that's a concept in training that you'll work with folks on as you begin to progress into using both elbow and hand simultaneously. An important but less commonly seen type of prosthesis is the hybrid. And the hybrid means a combination of components. While you may see a hybrid prosthesis which operates with a body-powered hand and an electric elbow, it is more common that you would see the body-powered elbow and the electric hand. If this is the system chosen for the individual, there are some pros and cons to consider with that hybrid system. One of the pros in using a hybrid system is for the individual that has an elbow disarticulation level amputation. With that level of amputation, if a person was to be fit with an electric elbow, most commonly there is a battery pack or some type of control system to operate the elbow, which occurs at the end of the humerus. In such a situation, with an electric elbow at that level of amputation, you would be adding too much length to the humeral piece, and then you would have asymmetry. So therefore, the body-powered elbow works better in terms of size. Another pro or advantage to the hybrid is the issue of cost. It may be less expensive than a totally myoelectric prosthesis. And a third advantage to the hybrid situation is that some individuals may be able to simultaneously operate the elbow and the hand. There are also some disadvantages to the hybrid that need to be considered. One of those is that the harness used in a hybrid situation must both suspend the prosthesis as well as offer a site of control. That can be difficult in terms of getting a harness that is appropriate for the wearer, that is comfortable, but that also provides adequate control for the prosthesis. Another disadvantage to the hybrid situation is that some elbow motion in terms of an individual operating their elbow may cause undesired hand motion. An individual may have difficulty isolating out the proximal muscles that operate that body-powered elbow without activating the myoelectric sites for the electric hand. And that can be a disadvantage. And a third disadvantage is that there is the necessity of mounting within the socket the electric cables that will operate the myoelectric hand. And these cables frequently can become impinged in that elbow joint. So it's important that the prosthetist working with fitting and the client understand that there needs to be freedom of movement of those electric cables. In terms of controlling the hybrid prosthesis, most commonly, when you are working with a body-powered elbow, you will use shoulder and biscapular abduction, which will pull on the cable, which will actually move the elbow. And Eric will demonstrate that for you. So he's abducting, and you are seeing elbow flexion. Very nice. To actuate the lock and unlock cable, which is on the inside of his particular socket, he needs to work with some shoulder depression. By depressing this shoulder, he will put some tension on this lock cable, which is positioned in front. In terms of operating the hand and the wrist rotator, the EMG signals are picking up biceps and triceps signal in the humeral piece, which allows Eric to rotate the wrist and then to transfer from wrist to hand function. To be able to switch from the electric function of the wrist to the electric function of the hand, Eric needs to do a quick co-contract of those two muscles. Very nice. Eric also, at times, is able to use the Greifer, which is interchangeable with the electric hand. So function of the wrist rotator allows him to rotate the Greifer, and the same EMG sites will allow him to open and close the Greifer. Function of the elbow and hand may be done by myoelectric control. That will occur if the individual has adequate and effective muscle sites to control the motor of the prosthesis. On occasion, an individual doesn't have the ability to generate enough signal in a muscle site, or perhaps there's some sensitivity in the skin to the electrodes with the constant contact. In such a situation as that, they are still a candidate for an electric prosthesis, and there are other methods of controlling that electric prosthesis. Two alternatives would be a simple switch control and also the possibility of using a ServoPro controller. The ServoPro controller is a force sensor. Kathy is utilizing a ServoPro controller on her chest strap. If you'd like to stand and show us where that's located. She has a ServoPro unit mounted on this strap, which is attached to her chest strap of her harness. If you want to turn around again, the ServoPro operates the electric motor by her body motions. It basically replaces the electrode. Show us how you bend and extend the elbow, or raise and lower the forearm.
Bringing the shoulder forward.
What Kathy is doing is pulling slightly and gently on that force sensor, which then transmit the signal to the motor to flex the elbow. When she slowly and gently relaxes that force, the arm will extend. As you pull harder, you'll have greater flexion. As you extend and relax more, you'll have greater extension. Very nice. Okay, Kathy, let me have you open and close that hand a few times. And to control that motion, you're using the same force and the same type of movement in the shoulder to trigger that ServoPro sensor.
Yes, same way to set the elbow where you want it.
Very nice. So as you're working with hand function, you're encouraging an individual to learn the control, full open, full close, partial open, partial close, and then also the concept of maintaining grasp, which would be holding steady, as you just did with that hand, which allows the hand to go to sleep. And in so doing, whatever hold is on the object will be maintained in that position. Very nice. Once you've actually reviewed hand function, then we get into the more complicated process, and that's why we actually put it near the end of the training, which is that of the function of unlocking the elbow. It is important to remind the individual that the hand must go to sleep prior to working with the elbow again. To unlock the elbow, there needs to be a quick pull on the force sensor. The key word is quick, just as we talked about with the myoelectric control. It isn't the amount of force, but the speed of force. Very nice. Can you describe for us what you did to activate that?
Well, first you have to relax entirely. That was always my biggest problem. I always found my shoulders slightly curled and not back in the home or relaxed position. So so that's probably one thing I have to still concentrate on.
Okay.
And then not pull hard, but just at quick.
Very nice. There's a whir, there's a sound of that motor that you can hear that tells you mm-hmm. that you've activated the motor
right.
to unlock. And once you hear that sound, then you can begin to actually move that forearm
right.
in the position of choice.
Yeah.
We go into pre-positioning, which is a very important concept. The idea that you need to train the individual to find the optimal position of the hand prior to engaging in an activity. So to practice that, I'm going to ask you to pick up a couple objects off
okay.
the table. The objects are of different sizes, Kathy, and of different heights. What I want you to think about as you approach each of these is, in the process of grasping that, where do you need to position the wrist or the hand for the optimal grasp?
I'll probably turn that, unless it has water in it. Then we
okay. If it had water in it, where would you need to grasp?
Down at the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I would get it more at the bottom. Now I have to wait. Let my hand go to sleep. Just I'm gonna get down lower. Can I use the other hand to lift it up?
Sure. I mean, you need to do what's as functional for you as possible.
Yeah, I'm fine if I bring it up higher.
Okay. Very nice. Okay, let's set the vase down.
Maybe.
And what you're working on here is making sure that you go home completely.
Right.
And then you can reactivate that
yeah.
hand. Very
That's
nice.
That's what I always have.
Mm-hmm. Now, as you reach for this object, it's important to educate the individual in the pinch position is what's occurring inside the hand.
Mm-hmm.
Should you have an item that's any smaller in dimension than about an inch or an inch and a half in height, the individual will constantly miss that object if they're grasping it off of a flat surface with their hand in a neutral position. So what would be the easiest way for you to approach this small block?
Do you want it by the block or do you want it by the, or by the top?
Well, for the purposes of training, let me have you reach around the block itself.
Okay,
very nice. Kathy was able to do that. You noticed that she used a little bit of forward flexion of the waist. She actually, rather than working with the elbow, leaned into her object. Go ahead and set that down. I'm going to ask you to consider turning your hand so that you approach the block from above. So let me see if you can position that hand so that you're coming down on top of your block.
From this position?
No, I want you to reposition the
okay.
hand.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Was that a little easier?
Yeah. That was
nice.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's look at the pill container. Okay, you would actually reach around so mm-hmm. you had more better access
that,
to it.
So I could reach the lid with the other hand, yes.
Beautiful. How about picking up tape dispenser so that you could actually pull a piece of tape off of it?
If you don't squeeze it too hard.
Nice.
There you go.
With too much force, you wouldn't be able to
yeah,
rotate that.
Right, the tape won't move at all or,
okay.
or you'll crush the dispenser, one or the other, I suppose.
Very nice.
Mm-hmm.
Again, it is very important in the aspect of training, in terms of functional use of the prosthesis, that you address pre-positioning. There are some issues that need to be taken into consideration with the higher level amputee. Specifically, the shoulder joint itself. Esther, if you can turn sideways for us. The therapist may see a variety of shoulder joints. Some joints are completely immobile. Some joints have a range of motion in flexion and extension. Some also include abduction. The shoulder joint that Esther is fit with is a friction joint. Esther, can you demonstrate how you can move your entire arm forward? Okay. Based on friction, friction will hold that into position. It takes a fair amount of strength from the other arm to do that. Can you push your arm behind you at all?
No.
Okay, so when you bring your arm back, Esther's arm positions at about midline and she doesn't have any friction extension capability. Does your arm move out to the side at all?
I can. It does.
Okay.
There.
Let me see if I can assist you. We'll have you lock your elbow again.
Okay.
She does have the ability to abduct with the shoulder joint, but the friction is set much lower, so she can't actually position this joint in abduction and then work in that position. But it does allow her to position sometimes to rest somewhere or to assist her in an activity. So it's important to notice that you may have a different type of shoulder joint, and it would behoove you to discuss that with the prosthetist to find out the abilities as well as the restrictions of that joint. In terms of working with the higher level amputee, myoelectrically, the control sites are usually weaker. There's less EMG feedback to be picked up by the electrodes, and that's an important consideration. Another consideration is the fact that co-contraction can be very difficult, and it's going to be a longer learning process for the higher level amputee in terms of learning to unlock the elbow because of the difficulty with co-contraction. Would you say at this point that you're beginning to master that function?
Pretty well.
Good. Was that a difficult function for you to learn, Esther?
Yes. It took a while.
The more
lots
proximal? Yeah, it's more difficult to isolate the muscles. So in terms of training now, you need to recognize that you do have that additional joint and that there will be another aspect of prepositioning that you'll bring into your training session. You're still going to follow the same concepts of beginning with simple activities, basic control training, working into use training that requires the function of the prosthesis as a stabilizer, where you talk about prepositioning and then move into more functional tasks. This section is about troubleshooting. The basic question is this the prosthesis error or the operator's error? And it's a pretty important step for us all to be aware of because we can facilitate an individual functioning with their prosthesis if we keep in mind a few particular areas that need to be looked at. Essentially, what we need to do is check controls and power to the prosthesis and also to educate the patient in doing that themselves. The first thing that you'll always want to check if there is a problem with the arm is that the battery is charged. When the battery is in the arm, it looks like a charged battery. There's really no way to tell if the battery is charged. So if you're having any trouble with function, the first step would be to remove the battery and put in a battery that you know is fully charged.
Turn it off? Before I change it, I always turn it off.
If you're home, you'll go to your charger and remove a brand new battery and put it in. I frequently encourage clients who come to the clinic for therapy that they always bring a fully charged battery with them. Regarding appropriate battery maintenance, it's important to help the client understand that they need to be aware of the life of each battery in terms of the amount of charge that it possesses, as well as the age of that battery. As the battery ages, it is possible that it maintains its charge for a lesser period of time. Kathy, as you remove that battery, then we will go ahead and demonstrate the appropriate areas of the battery compartment and the battery itself to keep clean. You have the blue contacts inside the elbow piece, as well as this reddened area inside the battery itself. Those contacts may be kept clean by the use of alcohol and a Q-tip to ensure that all dirt is removed from these two areas, and that will ensure proper battery connection. Once that you've checked the battery is inappropriately and fully charged, the next thing that you're going to want to check is that the power switches are on, both in the arm as well as in the hand. The forearm has the power switch here, the red dot that you see, and there's also a power switch in the hand. It's important to remember that each of the switches is turned on. The third thing that you will look at is whether or not the gains on the forearm dial are set where the prosthetist set them when the client was being fit. So it's important to check with the client. Are these the numbers that were set for you when you were working with your arm with your prosthetist? It's not real common, but it's possible for those gains to be affected by an individual reaching around the arm to turn it on and off, or possibly to have bumped that area. So it's important to check that those are set where they were set when the client came to you from the prosthetist. The next thing you'll want to check is that the arm itself is properly donned and that you do have good electrode contact. When a person removes the arm, you should see some impressions from the electrode on the skin itself. I'm going to ask you to remove your prosthesis so that we can look at your electrode contact. When Bob removes his prosthesis, we can then therefore see that there is demarcation on the skin where the electrodes were contacting the skin. And it's important to see that, to recognize that there was good contact. Occasionally, if an individual is demonstrating any irritation at the side of the electrodes, it would be important to discuss that with the prosthetist and to let them know that there is indeed a problem with either a painful area or a skin breakdown at the site of that electrode. Regarding the harness, it is important to make certain that all of the harness attachments are secure and that the harness is kept clean. With the various designs of harnessing available, it will be important to discuss with the prosthetist the removal technique for the particular harness that was designed. Kathy, as you go ahead and remove your harness and arm, we can demonstrate for them the feature that you have added to your harness. As Kathy has had some difficulty with maintaining cleanliness of her harness, she has chosen to use a terry cloth coverlet over the right axillary piece of the harness, which minimizes the amount of cleaning that you need to do by hand of your harness. The socket needs to be cleaned out very frequently, and this can be accomplished by simply wiping the socket after use and after wearing. It's also possible to clean the covers of the prosthesis. The socket and the forearm piece can be cleaned with any general household cleaner that is non-abrasive, similar to a 409 or any other type of mild cleanser. The glove can be cleaned, whether it is a PVC glove, which is polyvinyl chloride, or a silicone glove. The polyvinyl chloride glove is a more durable glove, but it also accepts stains readily and requires a little bit more effort to maintain it in its clean state. Beyond these four primary areas, any other problem with the arm is most often going to be related to something more complicated. At this point, what you need to do is try to define as specifically as you can and to clarify whether the individual is having difficulty with hand function, elbow function, or both. And at this point, then you will discuss with the prosthetist what you're seeing, what's happening in the clinical setting, and then consult with him or her as to the next step to take to remedy the situation. We appreciate your interest in viewing this training tape and hope that you find it very helpful to you as you work with clients in the future who will be wearing electric prostheses. Here are some additional resources that may be of help to you.
if there's a patient watching the videotape, and my perspective is from a therapist, they would like to hear from a real live patient, not another therapist who's not an amputee. They go, when is my phantom pain going to go away? I'm not an amputee, so I don't know. I have my own belief and thoughts about it, but mm-hmm. do you still have pain in your hand?
I still have sensation. I still distinctly feel my hand here. It feels like it's about like this.
Mm-hmm.
And it's at times when I'm physically relaxed, I feel like I can open the fingers almost a little. It feels good. All the rest of the time, my hand is closed into sort of a fist like this. It's just mm-hmm. there.
Does it hurt?
No, it doesn't hurt.
Do you think you've accommodated to it?
I think to a certain extent I've accommodated it. I ignored it in the beginning.
Huh.
It hurt like the dickens. I got medicated for it. When I left the hospital, the medication
really?
Ended, and it was either deal with it or don't. And I decided to just ignore it as much as I could.
Are you good at dealing with stuff like that in general?
Not always.
You know what I mean? Because some people just absolutely can't stop focusing on it.
Right.
And I just, either they're not patient enough or they just, they can't get beyond it.
It's something I couldn't deal with any other way. I mean, it was there. Mm-hmm. And if I wanted to, it was just there. And there wasn't any painkiller that they ever gave me that eradicated that. I always felt it.
So did you just quit taking the meds because they didn't?
Yeah, I didn't want to do it for the rest of my life. Mm-hmm. I mean, they were shooting me up with morphine, and they were real worried about whether or not I was going to need that for the rest of my life. So when I went home, they gave me a prescription, and the prescription didn't touch it. So I tried that once and threw away and just
really?
Went on after that. Mm-hmm. And I can't tell you exactly when I stopped feeling it. I just stopped noticing it.
Hmm. I just know that people, early on, they just always want to know how long they're going to have this pain. And it's such a personal issue. And you don't want to, I certainly don't want to lead them to.
For me, it went away. The pain side of it went away. Mm-hmm. The sensation is still there.
Mm-hmm.
I still feel I have that hand. Mm. It doesn't bother me. I just ignore it.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it tells me something about stress in me, too. When it's all wadded up and tight, then so am I.
Okay.
And I got to do something else, to relax.
Hmm.
But it hasn't been a block. It hasn't been a problem to me for 20 years.
Hmm.
So I'm thinking that sometime in the first year or two after I got out of the hospital was when it became a non-issue.
Have you worn other prostheses? Or were you
others.
Issued this and you've kept it forever?
Well, when I first needed a prosthesis, I didn't know anything about them except my uncle was a farmer and big in football and high school and things like this. He lost his hand in a corn picker.
Oh, really?
And he was a left wrist dysarthric, just like me. And I never saw him wearing a prosthesis, except we went to work to pick him up one day, and he was walking out of the back door of work, and he was pulling it off over his head.
That's the only time you ever saw it?
That's the only time I ever saw it. And he threw it into the back seat, and I asked him, why don't you wear that all the time?
Yeah.
And he said that the harness gave him problems here and this and that. There were things he just didn't like it. And so I was about 14 years old then, and it just went right up here in the memory bank.
Mm-hmm.
And when I went in to a prosthetic facility to get a prosthesis, I said, I need a tool of some kind. I didn't even know the word prosthesis.
Uh-huh.
And
you said, I don't want any of that strapping on me.
Well, that's pretty much what I said. He said, my prosthetist said, there's all kinds of options we have to talk about. And I said, well, I don't care what they are, as long as it doesn't have any straps or wires holding it on. And he said, well, that brings us down to leaves us the only option with one of these myoelectrics. And I chose the myoelectric because of the socket, because it didn't have anything else holding it on.
Mm.
It didn't matter to me whether it looked like a hand, whether it looked like a hook or a hoof. I didn't care. As long as I had grasp, that's what I wanted.
Mm.
And so I later got a body-powered style prosthesis. And I realized what he was talking about, and it has its advantages, but it didn't do for me what I needed it to do. Mm-hmm. It didn't give me the freedom of operation all over and the kind of accuracy that I needed. I don't know if that's exactly the right word, but it didn't fulfill everything that I needed, so I went back to this.
I'm just curious, many people just probably assume once they're fit, whether it's a financial thing for them or just because it's so hard to learn to do something else, once they get a prosthesis, they sometimes may feel stuck with it. And I just wondered if you tried a variety and ended up being able to choose something that you really wanted. Did you have a choice in that
I had the choice in the beginning. And my biggest problem personally was I didn't know anything about what I was buying. I mean, normally if I'm going to go buy a car or something like this, I know something about cars, but I didn't know anything about these things.
That's a good point.
And so I ended up with my first choice. It seemed to be just fine to me.
Uh-huh.
And but there were a couple little things about it. I couldn't take it on the water, sailing dinghies. That's why I got another prosthesis, was because I'd go into the water, and electric prosthesis in water is not a good idea. So I got this body-powered prosthesis. Now, while it wasn't everything that this was to me, it did have some advantages. I said I have it hanging in the closet, but I didn't say I threw it away.
That's true.
And there are things about it that give it advantages. If I was repetitiously heaving, carrying heavy loads, like if I worked on a farm and I was going to load 150 hay bales onto the back of a wagon, a repetitive, weight-bearing type of thing, I would probably choose to have a harness that would take some of that weight.
Mm-hmm.
But as soon as I was done with that task, I'd go in the house
and put the other one on.
That's
well, it's great that you've had a chance to try them out. And you're so adept at using that we don't see it. We don't see it. I don't see it on you. I don't see it as...
Well, a lot of people
an addition
tell me
to you.
That they never noticed that I'm wearing a prosthesis. Mm-hmm. And I think it's because I accept this as my tool. And I don't think of myself as being handicapped at all.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think of myself as an amputee. That's always something that other people point out. I was left-handed when I lost my hand. I think that aided in using the prosthesis in my everyday life.
Mm.
I wanted to get back to as normal an activity as possible, and so I'd incorporate this.
Mm-hmm.
And while I can get along without it, I'd prefer not to because I'm faster, better with it than without it. The other thing is learning to use this as a tool is an ongoing thing. I still learn things about it whenever I decide to take up a new activity, or I get a new kind of tool that I haven't used before, or something of this nature, and I have to learn how to use this tool with that tool. So when I start a new activity, there's
a little
usually a little
there.
Thing here that I have to learn to do with it.
Huh.
And when I was a little kid, I've told this to other people, I have watched my dad use a pair of pliers. And I realized that it was a pretty interesting tool. You could squeeze on this long end of it here, and the short end gave you quite a pinch. When I applied this to my brother, I got the desired result. When I also realized that there are other ways you can use the same tool. I can take the long handle end of it and stick it into his secret drawer and pry it open, right? I can smash ants on the floor with it as they go by and use it like a hammer. It was a tool that was designed to be used one way, but can be
but
used
there's
in
multiple
several ways.
Uses. So all of which got like you into this. Trouble, by the way.
depending on how fast these were. But I learned to use this in a number of different ways. I learned to use the friction coefficient of the glove to do work for me. I learned to use the phony fingers on the bottom to do work for me.
Mm-hmm.
I learned to use the different surfaces around the pinching area to do work for me in different ways. And that's what most people that find the challenge.
Well, it's fun and it's creative,
mm-hmm.
ultimately. You can be as creative as your mind will allow you to be, I guess.
Yeah, and it gets you back to where you were before you got amputated. It's not all the way, but on the way during that learning process, you learn to not be so concerned with this thing. This is not my identity.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's just a tool.
Mm-hmm.